for almost a century now. Popular culture and cinema in particular has been a major influence on what we think is pretty or attractive. And it was also Hollywood that more or less introduced us to plastic surgery. How has this changed the way we think about beauty? Is there such a thing as perfection? And what happens when, due to a revolution in makeup, Instagram filters, and plastic surgery, everyone can, at least in theory, start searching for their own perfect self? We will discuss this with Professor Gert-Jan Klein-Rensink and Professor Irene Matthijssen. Gert-Jan, Irene, you are a professor in anatomy, you're a professor in plastic surgery and craniofacial anomalies at Erasmus Medical Center. You are helping patients who were born with very serious facial anomalies. You are educating medical students, among others, in anatomy, working with real bodies in the Rotterdamse Snijzaal. So we will be getting you a little bit out of your comfort zone, discussing cosmetic and plastic surgery. Having said that, we will discuss the possibilities, how film, cinema, popular culture have been of influence on what we think is beautiful, whether there is something we can say about anatomical beauty, what that is, and we will have a sort of crash course in plastic surgery. Shall we start with that, Irene?
Yeah, sure.
We have lined up a couple of familiar faces, famous people, and up to you to tell us what has been done or has not been done, and whether it's been done any good. We're looking at Gert-Jan. Who's this?
This is Pamela Anderson, good friend of mine. So I know everything about her.
Okay.
Yeah.
Irene, what you can also see her on the screen over there at the end of the stage. What's interesting about Pamela Anderson?
Well, I think she was a major influencer in cosmetic surgery because she was one of the very first who had quite obviously done breast implants.
Mm-hmm. To put it mildly, yes.
To put it mildly, I think
which was somewhere in the 90s, I guess, right?
Yeah, yeah. But I think if you look at this picture, that's quite interesting to see her face, because that's there's lots to tell about this face. If you start from the top, it's a too smooth forehead. It's impossible at her age to have that smooth of a forehead.
Mm-hmm.
Just by your expression, you get these wrinkles. So that's Botox.
Whether you frown a lot or not, doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. Okay. You use this muscle all day long.
Okay.
So this.
So everyone, just to get it clear, everyone in the end will get this nervous looking kind of.
Well, these wrinkles are just from pulling up your eyebrows, which you do constantly for facial expression. And the other thing is that you usually, if you frown, you've got these little wrinkles down here. Most people hate that most. So this is also with Botox that you can just block the muscles, you know, the corrugator muscles, that you just
the corrigatory muscles?
Okay. Yes.
That's the name of these muscles.
That's the name, okay. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
It should be anatomically correct.
Yeah. So this is an obvious case for you.
That's quite obvious that's been done. In her case also, a nose job is like the basic stuff for Americans.
Okay.
So it's usually, and that's not for every American, of course, because it's expensive. But in
and a nose job meaning,
what a nose correction. So you wanna, they usually want a narrow nose, little upward tip of the nose.
Okay.
At the end, they all look the same. That's why you recognize them. It's like one model that they all want, and it's like in the high societies, the ones that can afford it. It's now like if you're turning 16. Then that's on your wish list for your birthday.
Okay,
you want
okay.
a nose job. That's in some cultures in the
States. So this is an easy case for
easy.
You. Okay,
yes.
let's go to.
What you also can say is that these. So you can ask yourself, okay, what is beauty? Huh? Why do these people want to have this nose?
Does it attract you in any way, Gert-Jan?
Well, there's a tendency that people will find female faces extremely attractive. Also, extra female for females. So that is lips, that is eyebrows, that is the nose, actually.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually interesting that also male persons looking more female are found more attractive by men and women, both.
Okay.
So the question Is there an absolute beauty? Is there points which you can say that, okay, when that, yeah, here you can see, this is interesting, because what's done here is Da Vinci calculated everything. You can see the circles, you can see the actually also the gulden snede.
It's the Fibonacci.
It's the gulden. It's the
gold snitch.
Gold's
I don't know.
The golden ratio. Anybody? Thank you very much. Golden ratio.
Sort of. Yeah.
Okay. Well, so that's applied here in this case. So it was completely calculated here, based on the.
So what you were saying that there is a mathematical basis for beauty.
Yeah. For the anatomical. Verhoudingen, but that's ratio.
And it even doesn't matter what kind of race you are. It's like that's universal.
Okay.
Yeah.
If you match these dimensions,
yeah,
then that's considered beauty.
Okay. Let's have a look at a couple of other famous people. We're going to look at this is a guy we all know, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gert-Jan, this is.
Yeah.
Michael Douglas.
Yes.
Yeah. So
what happened here, Irene?
What's quite well, if you go back one, because I think his neck is quite interesting. Can you go back one slide? Because what you see is this is too flat. This is impossible. Everyone wants this extremely flat lack of double chin. so what you see that his muscle down there, it's been plicated. It's been pulled all the way backward behind his ears. There you tighten it all the way.
So again, a normal guy of this age would have had a double chin.
He would have this little
automatism. I'm looking at your double chins, but
no, you
starting
can.
To evaluate. Yeah.
A little bit already. Yeah. But I'm young, so I'm still young. Yeah.
So this is just too straight. So that's definitely tucked away. Usually at this age, because I think he's in his 70s, something.
73, I guess.
You've got these little bags, because all the fat in your face slowly drops.
Mm-hmm.
And then you've got these little cheeks, like hamsters.
Mm-hmm.
They're completely gone. So again, it's all pulled away. He had a classical facelift to take that away.
But a classical facelift is what they...
Then you really make a big cut all the way in front of your ears, at the back, in your neck. And you just pull everything as tight as you can.
Okay.
So now he looks pretty good with this facelift, but in the first year
but
after
he does look aged, right? He doesn't look like a 25-year-old.
I think it's like 10 years ago that he had the traditional facelift. And then by now, you look good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Number three.
I think, by the way, he's got some skin cancer, didn't you?
Yeah.
Aging has a downside.
So, yeah.
This is a slightly older version.
Yeah.
When did the plastic surgery sort of explode in Hollywood circles?
Well, I think like in the 70s, it was starting.
Mm-hmm.
But at that time, you would like to have it that no one could tell. No one would want it to be noticeable. So mm-hmm. it had to be like subtle. And then slowly it became more common practice for everyone. And there has been a change that at a certain stage it was even fancy to show off, like, I had this done.
Okay.
And I think that's about in the 90s, that it was much more common. Everyone was discussing it, what they would like to have done and who did it.
Mm-hmm,
it was like...
Mm-hmm. But Marilyn Monroe, we were talking way back.
Yeah, at that time it was a big secret. You would not talk about what you...
Is there anything you notice looking at sort of the before and after... suggested?
Well, it's difficult because from her, you barely know her from moving images.
If
you see moving images, then it's quite easy to mm-hmm. tell, because with all these procedures, all movement, all mimics in your in your face change. Yeah. So then it's much more easy to detect.
Yeah. Okay, so this is a hard one for you guys.
Yeah, and what you can also say is that it's also rather... problematic to compare photographs.
Yeah.
So the real situation in which you look at people, there's also the social interaction combined with all kinds of anatomical mm-hmm. Features. So research, there's a lot of research done on these kind of things. And research always done on photographs. It's always done on composition photos, on combinations of faces, and so it's rather easy. But well, yeah, you can see a lot of things. Also, her left eyelid, something happened there also.
Yeah.
That's also anatomically not normal, but that's probably something.
Yeah, it's probably a correction of the upper eyelids, because in that picture you don't see the skin directly above your eyelashes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so probably some skin has been taken away, and the fullness of her upper eyelid, this part underneath your eyebrow.
This is something really
face.
Basic, right?
They
advertise with it when you go on the highway. It's 750 euros. Get your eyelids done, right?
That's
But what they did in those days, she had the fullness of your eyelids, which was considered not well at that time. You wanted to have the junky look, so they took out all this fat. So you have these flat and more deep-lying eyes.
Mm-hmm.
And if you then age, this really looks awful. So we don't do that anymore.
She didn't age.
No.
No, that's so why.
She didn't get a chance also, yeah. No. Yeah.
But number that would look awful if she turned 80.
Number four is more contemporary. Kajan, you know who this is? Or? I'm just checking.
We just had a little rehearsal beforehand, of course. I didn't know, but now I know. This is, of course, Kylie Jenner. Yeah, of course. But that's also one of the Kardashian family.
You didn't know her before, right?
No.
You didn't even know, you knew Kylie Jenner?
No.
Who in the audience knows Kylie Jenner?
But it's interesting. This is an interesting picture, because all the things I said about being female, mm-hmm. is the lips, is the eyebrows not too prominent, actually. They shouldn't be too prominent. The jawbone is also not too prominent. That's all male characteristics of the anatomy. And she has corrected all these elements. And there has also been some research done on, okay, you have the female aspects, female characteristics. And then when you make a photo and you improve these facts, more lips, more, then the people like that more. So the more you look like a woman,
mm-hmm.
the better. And that's also, again, also in men, except, and that's interesting, during the ovulation. Then women want to have a male-looking man.
Okay.
But that's only in this small period. After that, it's again gone, and they're looking for more caring, more a man, more having parents.
Okay.
Like,
so there's hope for us.
More female.
As well.
Yeah. Yeah.
At least we stay out of the ovulation period.
Couple of days only.
She is one of the first self-made billionaires with selling her image, selling beauty, selling the way you can create beauty. What does this say about this time, that this is one of the beauty symbols?
Well, a big change that's been done, I think, in the last 10, 15 years is that before that time, it used to be like you're starting to age, you turn 40, and then you would consider doing something to look better, to mm-hmm. stay young. Nowadays, it's like you turn 18, and then it's time to start restoring stuff, preventing any aging, and that's a completely different ball game. I think there is a lot of industry behind it, because,
mm-hmm.
For instance, all the lips that are stuffed with all these fillers to give them fullness, they put it in cheekbones, they put it everywhere to make fullness. It's really available. It's very cheap.
Mm-hmm.
You can get it at the dentists do it. Every time.
It's forbidden, right? For the dentist, it used to be allowed for dentists,
Since last year it's forbidden. But it's really everywhere. There's these parties that you can go to, and for a few euros, you get all these fillers into your face,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
and they start really early. You can start at 18, because then it's legal to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just a business.
And when this started, the fillers and the Botox, it was considered dangerous as well, right? Is that still the case, or is it relatively safe to do things?
No, there's been big changes. So I think one of the large fillers that we used to start with was with Vanessa, the Dutch singer. She started her own company, And that was a permanent filler that was used. And you see in some of these faces where they used permanent filler, that stays forever. And it gets rejected by your body. You get inflammations, and you get all these scarring and hard bits that you sometimes have to cut out.
Mm-hmm.
So then they were banned when they really saw after 10 years, like, this is really bad. And now you have these fillers that disappear by themselves, which is even nicer for industry. So you have to come back every time to get some more.
The business model has improved.
Yeah.
I want to look at one last example. It's Paul Rudd. A guy who seemingly doesn't age. This is him through the years. Sort of boy next door image he does have. Gert-Jan, is this... this is the sort of not really male type you were describing, right?
Yeah. So caring... Well, there's some aspects. There's also the aspect of symmetry, which if you get the last picture, the former picture... You can see he has a rather symmetrical face, so everything is in order. You could say.
And symmetry is.
So that has two basic explanations. So why we like symmetry? One is evolutionary. A symmetrical face is a healthy face.
Mm-hmm.
So people look at a person to find a mate, for instance. These are the measures. That 1.618 is the gulden snede. That's the measure of the gulden snede, overigens. But that's one explanation. So we want to look at healthy persons, and a healthy person is a good person, etc. So
almost no one has a symmetrical face, right?
No. The second explanation is that we like symmetry in our brain. So we are kind of wired to accept symmetrical forms, and it's easier for us to accept a symmetrical form as an asymmetrical form. So that's the both explanations. But it's a big issue, symmetry.
Yeah.
Symmetry. Yeah.
So this is a symmetrical face.
Yeah.
Irene, but the question is it a natural symmetrical face?
No. It's definitely not. A normal aging face, because again, the forehead is completely flat, no wrinkle whatsoever at his the level of his eyebrows.
Really, to double check, it is impossible for a guy. I think he's in his early 50s. It's impossible to not have this frowning.
Yeah. Okay. So what they do is they use Botox, because that just kills your muscle movements, so you cannot frown. So that's what you see in actors, which is quite strange.
I'm still processing that I will receive this thing, whatever I do, unless I do.
Second photo, he has some wrinkles, some vertical wrinkles here.
Yeah, but Botox works just for 6 to 9 months.
Yeah.
So you can use it, and it dies on you, and then the muscle function is restored. But this is definitely Botox that he's been using, and all these, for instance, you should have a fold down here, the nasolabial fold, because of the sagging of your cheeks. And what they usually do is they fill it up with fillers so it doesn't look like a true wrinkle.
Mm-hmm.
So that's all little tricks, and he definitely had some of these.
You can see it decrease also, from the fourth to the fifth, this wrinkle's gone.
He doesn't smile anymore on the last one. That's a good trick.
Is it a strategy? If you want to stay young, can you not smile and not show emotions and
No, but for pictures, because they're quite aware, of course, as an actor, that if you don't smile too wildly, too expressively, you have less wrinkles on a picture.
Okay.
And the picture goes wild. So on the internet.
Yeah,
and you inject it really with a toxin. This is a real hard toxin, so you paralyze the muscles. So smiling isn't even possible in some people. You cannot smile anymore because the muscles, your facial muscles are paralyzed, so they can't work anymore.
And you are, announced it at the beginning, you are working with bodies of deceased people.
Yeah, they don't smile anymore.
No, they don't smile anymore. You are trying to educate students in anatomy, in how a body looks like or should look like. Are you increasingly receiving bodies with breast implants or with fillers or what? And can you say something about how that has influenced the way you work with...
Yeah, That's really a problem. I mean, breast implants is for us rather hard to analyze. You cannot have the muscles anymore. So and it's strange. There's plastic really into the tissue. So it increases. It's not that we see this, well, hundreds of times a year. That's not the case. But yeah.
It can also be the case that the people who say I want to give my body to science are not per se the people who go into plastic surgery.
That's something we cannot say.
Okay.
No, I'm not aware of that mechanism. No.
Okay. No. Irene, because you are not, to put it clear again, you are not doing eyelid corrections for €750. You're working in an entirely different field. Can you say something about how the popularization of plastic surgery and the democratization, maybe, that it's available for everyone, how that has changed your work and the patients you work with?
I think that it's so popular on television nowadays. So you've got all these magazines, all these television shows, and they're all commercial. Hardly anyone pay notice that the very first announcement of these programs is like, this program has been made possible by, and then there's this company that sponsors it.
Mm-hmm.
And then you get these patients, they have like a minor surgery, that's how they present it, never have any complications.
Mm-hmm.
They're much more happy afterwards, they get jobs, boyfriends, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And that just creates an atmosphere like it's achievable for all. It's very safe, nothing ever goes wrong, and you have got a sort of right on getting this kind of surgery done.
Mm-hmm.
So it completely falsifies all expectations that patients sometimes have.
Because a lot of things do go wrong.
There's always complications. You have to make scars. There's everything can go wrong, what you do in surgery.
Mm-hmm.
And just patients really come in and say, a scar, but you're a plastic surgeon, so you don't make scars, do you?
And but at the same time, really a lot of things are possible, right? The science fiction movie, a Face Off with Nicolas Cage and John Travolta, who changed faces.
Yeah.
This was science fiction about 20 years ago, I think, in the late 90s, I would say. But in the meantime, some of your colleagues have done complete face transplantations, right?
Yes. But that has a downside, because it's really nice to talk about how you can transplant a face from one to another.
Mm-hmm. This is a patient of a French colleague of yours,
but
right?
But the downside is that if you do this, you need really severe medication to prevent that the face is rejected by your body, because it's a face from someone else. It will mean if you get a transplant of a face from someone else today, you're pretty sure to be dead in 10 years' time. Because of all this medication, you get cancers. And they're untreatable at a certain stage.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to be really badly affected to really accept a new face and be dead in 10 years' time.
Yeah.
No one talks about that downside. It's
so
like,
we should not expect
cool is this?
Should not expect too much of it.
Well, you need to be honest. Like, there's a big downside of these interventions. And if it's like a really severe case, then you're more likely to accept risks than if you're healthy, looking fine, and just want to look a little bit better. So how much risk are you accepting for those tiny improvements? So I've seen patients coming in from South America because it's really cheap and everyone is willing to do any kind of surgery or intervention. And they had the most weirdest stuff putting into their bodies, like cement, silicone oil, like liters a day. And that's horrible, the results of that. Those could really kill you. And people take these risks because they have the impression from internet, from television shows, that it's all safe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. There is a distinction between your world, the plastic surgery in the hospital, and the private sector, the plastic surgeons working in private clinics. Mm-hmm. To what extent are they regulated and educated? Are you, for example, teaching...
That's an interesting question, because since the introduction of their registration in, I think, July, One of the things is that they have to have an anatomical practical to learn where not to inject, how these injections are placed. And yeah, there was in the first place, it was kind of a dilemma because it's not patient care.
Mm-hmm. It was a dilemma whether you,
so whether
as
we
head
should,
of the
yeah.
anatomy.
Yeah, yeah. We could use the bodies of the people who donate their bodies to science and education. That's mm-hmm. the term. Can we use this also for this kind of, interventions, you could say? And then we thought about it, and okay, there is one movement, and that's the dermatologists and the plastic surgeons and the ear, nose, and throat surgeons. They came together and they formed actually a group in which they said, okay, well, this is a kind of jungle now at this moment. Everybody does it, and it's the dentist, et cetera, et cetera. So what we can do is we can regulate it. And one of the things you should do before you place any injection into the face, actually, you should know where to do it. Where's the nerves? Where's the vessels? Can we put the injection in the neighborhood of the eye nerve, whatever. So, yeah, we decided to do it. We decided to do it. And
so you're helping them to...
Yeah, but only for this group of people. Only for the registered cosmetic doctors, they are called. Yeah. Not cosmetic surgeons, but cosmetic doctors. And they are doctors. They are working in these kind of practices. And, well, they found out that we had to regulate it. And then one of the... things they should do is come to our lab and practice these kind of injections. And yeah, that was something we decided to do. Although it was not actually patient care, but it was preventing being patients.
Yeah.
And that was the reason we did it. But it's in a very small setting. It's not a lot of people doing this, and we only want to get to departments related to our academic center.
Okay.
That is
last question for you both. I have to ask, if you had to choose anything to fix in your own body or face, what would it be?
No, I'm perfect. Yeah.
Obviously.
Yeah. Well.
Irene, you're not a huge fan of doing something when it's not completely necessary, right?
No.
This means.
No, no wishes. I think that from all procedures, the upper eyelid blepharoplasty, so just taking off some skin,
mm-hmm.
it helps a lot, but for physical complaints. So you've got sometimes 80 or 90-year-old people just pulling up their eyelids to be able to read. And I think,
mm-hmm.
well, let's not call that cosmetic procedures.
Okay.
That's really
you
a
should just
one.
Do that if it bothers you. Is there anything I should... do
or perfect
I'm perfect as well.
Perfect
okay, thank you. Irene Matthijs en Gert-Jan Kleirensink.